Our sun wakes up from its snooze with a big solar flare and a partially Earth-directed solar storm that's going to give us a glancing blow. Those stories and more in the news this week. If you want to learn how weather from our star causes impacts at the Earth that shape the future of our world, join professors Dr. Jenny Meehan, Michael Cook, and myself as we guide you through a space weather certificate program like no other. To enroll in the Space Weather and Environment Science program offered at Millersville University, go to millersville.edu/swen. It's weather for the 21st century. This forecast also sponsored in part by CW Ops. Our sun wakes up from an extended snooze over this past week. As we take a look at our Earth-facing disk, we do have a lot of active regions in Earth view, but most of these are really stable. However, we did have region 3403 launch a solar storm to the west of Earth. That was back on the 21st. And then on the 22nd, we had region 3413 launch a solar storm to the east of Earth. Finally, though, we had region 3404 and 3405 get into the fray. And they launched some solar storms that are Earth-directed. The first was from region 3404. It was kind of a wispy solar storm. Looks like that one's going to go mainly west of Earth, but it could have a glancing blow component. And then on the 23rd, region 3405, pow, fires an M1 class flare. That caused a small radio blackout on Earth's day side, but then also launches a solar storm in two parts. You see that first horseshoe shape? That's the first part. And then the second part is this structure that goes south of Earth. So it makes kind of a convoluted structure as we look at it in coronagraphs, which makes it really hard to model, but it looks like we could get a grazing component from that. So we do have at least one, if not two, solar storms, but they're kind of going off to the west of Earth, and that's going to arrive right about the time we get a little bit of fast solar wind from some from a coronal hole that's going to be passing through the Earth strike zone just barely. So we could get a little bit of a disturbance. It's not going to be all that much. It's likely going to be limited to high latitudes, but hey, finally, it's a wake-up call. Now, switching to our sun's far side, we can no longer rely on stereo A imagery to give us decent images of the sun's far side, so we use JSOC HMI helioseismology as well as SDO, AIA, and HMI imagery from about 2 weeks ago to give us an idea of what might be lurking on the sun's far side. And as we take a look at that, at those images, you can see region 3386. That region is actually now rotated off of the far side onto the front side of the sun. This is now region 3314. And on the front side of the sun, it is the one that's firing solar storms and is going to be rotating into the Earth strike zone. But region 3386, is, as it used to be known as, was actually a pretty big flare player back one full rotation ago. So we are going to be keeping our eyes on it because we're not quite sure it's all fizzled out yet. Now, on top of that, we are also watching region 3398. This region is going to be rotating back into Earth view here in the next couple days. This region actually started to grow just as it was leaving the west limb, as you can see it there as it rotated to the sun's far side. And on the far side, as we bring up our helioseismology far side viewer, you can see region 3398 really started growing in intensity. You can tell by that black spot how dark it is. That shows you that that region is continuing to grow. And as it rotates back into Earth view, it could be either a solar storm player or possibly a big flare player as well. So, you know, we do have some activity on the far side yet that could definitely keep that solar flux boosted and keep solar storms and big flares on the menu. Now, taking a closer look at the solar storms that were launched that were partially Earth-directed, we switch to our solar storm prediction model, ENLIL. Now, this is NOAA's version of the model. The top panel's density, the bottom panel's velocity. You're looking down at the sun from the North Pole with Earth being off to the right. And as we take a look at the solar storm launch, you can see it there launching basically west of Earth. It looks like a very soft, wispy, green crescent. And that's mainly because the solar storm is going southwest of Earth, so you don't see a really good impression of it here. But as it reaches Earth, notice that there's a pinwheel that's right behind it. Well, that pinwheel is actually the influence from some fast solar wind that's going to be hitting, and it's almost going to be impacting Earth right at the same time the solar storm is going to hit. So we could get kind of like a 1-2 punch from a solar storm and then some fast solar wind, which could enhance things. But this solar storm is wispy at best. We are expecting the impact to be sometime mid to late day on the 27th, but probably only going to give us some aurora or some disturbances up at high latitudes. Not expecting a big aurora show down at mid latitudes from this one, but if you are at high latitudes and you're a aurora photographer, you could definitely get something over maybe the 27th and the 28th, and possibly if we had something from that earlier storm, might see something late on the 26th as well. Switching to our moon, we are now passing through the first quarter phase on our way to a full moon, and by the 28th, the moon will be about 90% illuminated. So you night sky watchers, if you want to catch, I don't know, maybe the waning parts of the Perseids or possibly some aurora, well, you're going to have this bright companion to contend with, so you're going to need to check your local rise and set times. Switching to our solar storm conditions and aurora possibilities over the coming week, we are anticipating that solar storm glancing blow along with a fast solar wind chaser, and that should be hitting Earth here over this weekend. Now, we're not expecting a very strong impact from either of these things, but having them hit together could actually enhance us just a little bit and cause a little bit of aurora, especially at high latitudes. In fact, at high latitudes, we're going to be expecting active conditions, but we have up to about a 30% chance of a major storm, and the peak of it should be right around the 27th. But we could get a little bit of storming before that from that earlier solar storm that also looked like it could give us a glancing blow. And then the effects of that fast solar wind are going to linger into the 28th. So right around that 27th, expect that to be the biggest chance for aurora, but you could get chances for aurora from the 26th through the 28th and possibly the 29th before things begin to calm down. So aurora photographers, hey, this could be a decent chance for you. Now at mid-latitudes, the story isn't quite so bright. We are expecting only unsettled conditions, even though we are going to be seeing these storms hit. But we do have about a 10% chance of minor storm conditions. Most likely, if it lasts, it's going to be very sporadic. So aurora photographers, only if you're dedicated should you chase, because really the solar storms that we're expecting and the fast solar wind may not be enough to bring that aurora down to mid-latitudes. Switching to our solar flare and dayside radio blackout outlook over the coming week, we do have a lot of active regions in Earth view, but we don't have a lot of big flare activity. And this is actually good news because we also have solar flux staying in the 150s that actually is going to ramp up likely into the 160s before week's end because of some of the new regions rotating into Earth view. This means amateur radio operators and emergency responders, there's really good dayside flux, which means good radio propagation on Earth's dayside. We also have minor noise on the bands right now because of the lack of flare activity. NOAA's giving us about a 10 to 15% chance of M-class flares. That's at an R1 to R2 level radio blackout, and that's likely going to continue over the next 5 days or so. We might see an increase as we get to the end of the week. It all depends upon what those new regions look like when they rotate into Earth view. But we do really have no risk for X-class flares at an R3 level radio blackout, so definitely enjoy the great radio propagation on Earth's dayside, and GPS users, enjoy decent GPS reception even at dawn and dusk. Switching to our radiation storm and polar aviation outlook over this coming week, everything is in the green when it comes to radiation storms. Everything is nice and quiet right now. We're sitting at the D1 normal range for you aviators, and this is at flight level 360, which also is the S0 level for everyone else. And we really don't have any risk for radiation storms at the S1 or S2 level because we just don't have any big flare players on the Earth-facing disk right now, and this is easily going to last out through this week. So you frequent flyers and air crew and pilots, you're all in the clear. So the space weather this week is definitely more active than last week. We do have that glancing solar storm blow that's going to be followed by some fast solar wind. So aurora photographers, if you're at high latitudes, you definitely could get a bit of a show. You could start looking late on the 26th into the 27th and then possibly into the 28th before things begin to calm down. So enjoy that. Now, aurora photographers at mid-latitudes, well, it's not quite so clear for you. We're not expecting a really strong impact. So only if you're dedicated should you chase, and even then make sure you take long exposures with your cameras, because sometimes the camera can see things that our eyes just can't. Now, amateur radio operators and emergency responders, you're loving this week because we still have high solar flux in the triple digits, but we don't have those big radio blackouts right now because we don't have a lot of big flare players on the Earth's facing disk. So enjoy decent radio propagation with very little noise on the dayside bands probably all week before things could possibly change. And now, GPS users, well, you're also in luck because we don't have any really strong solar storms happening and we don't have any big radio blackouts. So GPS reception pretty much all over the globe should be top notch. I'm Tamitha Scove, the Space Weather Woman. Thank you for watching.
It's time to get your news on. We are VK1WIA.
And bringing the news to you this week, I'm Graham, VK4BB. You'll hear WIA Secretary and Director of the Wireless Institute of Australia, Peter Klee, VK8ZZ. VK2JNA has an unusual CW contact of sorts whilst on the road. Mark, VK4DMH, President of the Gold Coast Amateur Radio Society and their involvement with last weekend's Pacific Air Show. Cole, VK3GTV, with arguably ham radio's best rescue radio planning. And, although not really falling into the news category, AR Magazine Editor-in-Chief Roger Harrison, VK2ZRH, does a little scientific pondering. But let's wander up to Darwin and your WIA Secretary.
Thank you. Good morning, Graham. I hope you are well after your extended trip around the country and your last week being away from the National News Desk. This is WIA Secretary and Director of the Wireless Institute of Australia, Peter Klee, VK8ZZ. I took part in the Remembrance Day contest earlier this month at the club station, VK8DA. We set up a portable station running on solar power and barbecued sausages at the East Point Reserve, adjacent to the East Point Military Museum and the historical gun emplacements at East Point. The bands were not as active as I would have expected, but the station did well and our log has been submitted. The International Lighthouse and Lightship Weekend was last weekend, and again the bands were not as active as I would have hoped. The Darwin Amateur Radio Club will activate the Cox Peninsula Lighthouse next year. Over the last few months, we've advised of several new and existing positions that needed to be filled by members to assist the board in the operation of the Institute. At a recent meeting of the board, the following positions have been filled and advertised in the September-October edition of Amateur Radio Magazine and on the WIA news pages. We are pleased to confirm the following appointments. Technical Advisory Committee Chairman is Grant Willis, VK5GR. Technical Advisory Committee Member, Technical Advisor C4FM, is Peter Jung, VK5JP. Technical Advisory Committee Member, Technical Advisor DMR, is Peter Brennan, VK3TE. And Technical Advisory Committee Member, Technical Advisor P25, is Steve Kennedy, VK6SJ. The Ross Hull Memorial VHF and UHF Contest Manager is Tom Blunt, VK2TBC. The Spectrum Strategy Committee Standards Australia Committees TE003 and TE003/19 is Peter Picorni, VK2EMR. The WIA National and Inward QSL Manager is Mike Adams, VK3KMA. Congratulations to those appointees. We very much thank the retiring members for their hard work and assistance to the Institute. The retiring Ross Hull Memorial VHF-UHF Contest Manager, Ted Thrift, VK2ARA. The retiring Spectrum Strategy Committee Standards Australia, TE003, is Ron Cook, VK3AFW. and retiring WIA National and Inwards QSL Manager, John Siemens, VK3JLS. Thank you, gentlemen, for your contribution to the Wireless Institute of Australia and to amateur radio in Australia. The WIA runs almost entirely on volunteers. We have only one paid employee who operates out of our national office. The 7 board members of the Institute and well over 100 committee and group members are all unpaid volunteers who run this Institute for the benefit and betterment of amateur radio service. Without our army of hardworking volunteers, we would simply not be able to operate. Thanks, Graham. Back to you.
VK2JNA had an unusual CW contact of sorts whilst on the road. He'd just driven home from Canberra and whilst on the road near Paddy's River, saw a couple of low-flying military aircraft. He reckoned they could probably see him on the highway, so he signalled them with Morse 3 times by his headlights. It seems the lead aircraft did see him as the plane tipped his wings in acknowledgement, and that was good enough to also get that story back on ABC Canberra. Speaking of those magnificent men and their flying machines, buckle up for this next story, which you can also hear a much longer report in Q News. Just go to wiaq.org.au.
Hi, I'm Mark, VK4DMH from GCARS on the Gold Coast. The Gold Coast Amateur Radio Society was involved with radio communications for the Pacific Air Show last weekend, providing scheduled timing and aircraft movement updates from the various airfields back to the Air Show Command and Service Paradise. There were 10 amateur radio operators engaged for 3 days at 4 different airfields and locations, spanning a distance of close to 100 kilometres. Many of us also had aircraft radio certifications so we could communicate with the pilots on airband as necessary. A complete new 70-centimetre network was commissioned for the event, designed and built by Andrew, VK4QF. In addition, we installed a crossband aviation to commercial UHF repeater on a high-rise in Service Paradise, giving the airshow bosses an expanded area of aircraft radio coverage. There were 50 aircraft participating in the airshow with both civilian and military machines, some first flown in the 1940s. Each airfield presented unique issues for our amateur radio operators as we needed to see and report on each aircraft from pushing out of the hangar to engine startup, taxiing, then finally takeoff. The Service Paradise Command Centre crew were well prepared to deal with the continuous loud aircraft noise from the airshow. They had noise-cancelling pilot headsets connected to their handheld transceivers. Seated alongside our 2 amateur radio operators in the Service Paradise Command Centre were 2 Air Services Australia representatives and a CASA representative. The 3 air bosses were able to get the latest aircraft updates from our crew, and all 3 groups constantly liaised on aircraft movements, including those aircraft in the area that weren't in the air show. GCAS is already planning the radio coverage for next year's event. 73, Mark, VK4DMH from the Gold Coast Amateur Radio Society.
This is Roger Harrison, VK2ZRH. National Science Week has just concluded, which reminded me that, in one sense, amateur radio has science as its basis. Think about it. Every time you turn on your rig and call CQ, or join a net, or take part in a contest, you're conducting a scientific experiment. Remember when you did science in high school and had to write up an experiment? I recall having to set out the objective, the means, the method, and the results. Think about that. When you turn on your rig and set it to, say, 20 metres, for example, your objective is to make contacts. The means is about the equipment, in this case, your microphone, your transceiver, your feed line, and your antenna. The method concerns the details of how you go about making a contact. Selecting a band and a frequency or channel, what sort of antenna you select, if it's a beam, the direction you pointed it, included here is that CQ call. The result for this scientific experiment is making a contact with a station that responds to your CQ call and writing that in your log. So, if you joined in the Remembrance Day contest, I trust that you enjoyed it. The last time I joined in the RD, I never managed to make a contact. It was 1970. August is still winter in Antarctica, and there's only a couple of hours of twilight around midday. The RD contest arrived, and I tuned into the opening broadcast with bated breath. The signal on 40 metres was 5x7x9 with slow QSB. As it began to end, the signal faded alarmingly. Silence. Tune up, tune down, nothing. Check the antenna connection. All good. Call again. No response. Tune the band. More silence. I phoned my ionospheric physicist friend elsewhere on Casey. He said something like, "Sorry, mate, there's a polar cap absorption event in progress. The delayer sucked up all signals. No HF communications for the polar regions." The bands didn't come good until Monday. My grand scientific experiment on the outer bands was a bust. This has been Roger Harrison, VK2ZRH. Thanks for listening.
From here, there and everywhere, you've tuned to the Wireless Institute of Australia's National News Service. We are VK1WIA. Now with international news, Jason, VK2LAW.
Hello. Leading this week's international news from Region 1, IARU Region 1 Monitoring System newsletter. The latest edition has been published and includes a report regarding the successful resolution of a case. A transmitter undergoing testing that's part of an international scientific radar network called the Super Jewel, a rural radar network operating in the 20-metre band. The report covers how it was detected and brought to a satisfactory conclusion. In news from California, amateur radio operators activated last Sunday, August 20, to provide communications and information for Tropical Storm Hillary. Heavy rains were falling in San Diego, and local media reported that 250 airline flights had been cancelled. Amateur radio operations began that Sunday morning with Whiskey X-Ray 4 November Hotel Charlie, amateur radio station at the National Hurricane Center, on air. This was the first tropical storm to hit California since 1939. To Puerto Rico, will Arecibo Observatory ever do science again? Although it's slated to become an education centre, astronomers hope research one day might return to the site. After weathering hurricanes, earthquakes, budget cuts and a pandemic-induced shutdown, the iconic Arecibo Observatory in Puerto Rico closed its doors on the 14th of August. After its main instrument collapsed 2 years ago, the site was supposed to shift from carrying out astronomy to being a science education centre. But concrete plans for that have yet to materialise, and funding for current operations has run out. The observatory's main attraction, a 305-metre wide dish that was responsible for, among other things, studying near-Earth asteroids, discovering exoplanets and observing gravitational waves, was destroyed in 2020 when some support cables snapped following years of delayed maintenance. To Hawaii. Emergency officials in Hawaii have begun using AM broadcast equipment to help communicate with the public during the wildfire recovery efforts in Maui. The State of Hawaii Emergency Management Agency has purchased 4 RadioStat portable emergency advisory stations. The Wireline Competition Bureau of the Federal Communications Commission granted the state of an emergency authorization to use at 4 locations, including checkpoints and police and fire stations. To news from Kuala Lumpur, the Borneo Post has run a great story of that area on ham radio. In today's digitally driven world, where instant communications is often taken for granted, a powerful yet overlooked tool remains ready to serve in times of crisis. Amateur radio. Imagine this scenario. Your phone is out of power, the electrical grid is down, and there's no cellular signal. Desperation sets in as you try to reach authorities for help. Enter amateur radio. A versatile communication medium that thrives under these adverse conditions. Amateur radio operators, also known as hams, step up to provide a crucial communications lifeline. They can connect over open frequencies to share vital information, coordinate rescue efforts, and maintain a lifeline when all other forms of communication fail. Well done to the BorneoPost.com. Now for Weird and Wonderful. If you've been making up for lost years of travel, you might have seen a fellow traveller in the airport terminal walking with their luggage happily careening behind them. Hackaday are reporting on a project from a couple who wanted more of that. They wanted an open-source, low-cost system that could be put in anything. The basic principle is that they have a transmitter that sends both a radio signal and an ultrasonic pulse. The receiver receives the radio signal and uses it as a reference for the two ultrasonic sensors. The time since the radio signal is compared between the two, and a distance and direction are established. In practice, the radio and ESP32-S3 using ESP Now, a protocol from Esperif that offers low latency 250 bytes payloads, the ultrasonic transceiver is based on SparkFun's HCSR04. The prototype the team built was an electric wheelbarrow that would happily follow you around the yard wherever you go. For VK1 WIA National News, in Sydney, I'm Jason, VK2LAW.
We are VK1 WIA. Now, operational news with VK4 FUQ, Felix.
Hello there. Now, contest-wise, RT contest, get your logs in pronto. Today is the last day for log submission, Sunday, the 0300 hours Zulu.
Hi, this is Alan, VK4 Sierra November, the Remembrance Day contest manager. My internet service provider sometimes thinks that logs coming to me is spam and are blocked. So please make sure that if you've sent a log that your call sign is showing in the submitted logs link on vklogchecker.com. If not, please email me. Details are on the WIA Remembrance Day page. I also type up paper and attach logs to email and submit to vklogchecker.com. All operators will get an automated acknowledgement when submitted, and success or failure is actually shown on the screen when the log is submitted. Good luck. This is Alan, VK4, Sierra November.
Thanks, Alan, VK4SN. August 26-27, Alara contest is this weekend. Also this weekend, the CQ RITI Ops Worldwide RITI contest, which has two sessions between the 25th and 27th of August. The first session is between 2200 hours UTC on the 25th and 1200 hours UTC on the 26th. The second session is from 1200 hours to 2359 hours UTC on Sunday the 27th, using RITI only on the 160 to 10 meter bands where contests are permitted. The exchange is signal report and the 4-digit year of your first license. The luck of the Irish. IRTS SSB Field Day. The IRTS SSB Field Day will take place from 1300 hours UTC next Saturday, September the 2nd, to 1300 hours UTC on Sunday, September the 3rd. Activity will focus on SSB phone contacts in the 3.5, 7, 14, 21, and 28 MHz bands. October, Oceania DEX Contest. Phone, the first full weekend in October each year. 0600 hours UTC, Saturday to 0600 hours UTC, Sunday. CW, second full weekend in October from 0600 hours UTC, Saturday to 0600 hours UTC, Sunday. November, VHF UHF Spring Field Day, 25-26 November. DX window, first we see through the window is right here in Australia. VK5's Amateur Radio Experimenters Group have been celebrating their 25th anniversary with special event call sign VI-25AREG. VI-25AREG ceases operation Thursday, August 31. Nauru. C21TS is on the HF bands using FT8 and SSB. QSL. C21TS. Via M0OXO. Mariana Island. QRV as KH0-DL2AH from Ruta Island until September 14 on 80 to 6 meters using SSB and FT8. QSL direct to home call, which of course is DL2AH. Asiatic Russia. RI0Z from Ringer Island, IOTA AS039, until September 3, marking the 30th anniversary of the Russian Robinson Club. Activities on 160 to 10 meters using CW, SSB, and various digital modes. QSL via operator's instructions. LA100K is the special call sign in use by the Akademisk Radio Club, LA1K, to celebrate the 100th anniversary of its foundation. It is the oldest amateur radio club in Norway. The special call sign will be in use until the 31st of December, and QSL route is very easy, via the Bureau or direct. For VK1WIA National News, I'm Felix, VK4FUQ in Ingham.
From here, there and everywhere, you've tuned to the Wireless Institute of Australia's National News Service. We are VK1WIA. Now, special interest group news with VK3FFF, Bruce.
And a very good day to you. Worldwide Special Interest Groups Digital. Echolink's Jonathan Taylor, K1RFD. Graham, VK2FA joins us.
The next Hunter Radio Group meeting will be held on Thursday the 14th of September at the Electronics Section at Newcastle TAFE. This meeting, to our knowledge, will be the first time this has happened in Australia. The meeting will be an online lecture by Jonathan Taylor, K1RFD. Jonathan is the gentleman who developed the popular amateur radio program Echolink. He is an outstanding speaker, and we feel this lecture is one not to be missed. Echolink has just under 500,000 users validated on the system and is a tool used to link licensed radio amateurs all over the world, including people who have had to move into nursing homes and no longer have access to their radio equipment. Echolink is also an asset for licensed amateurs travelling overseas who can't take their radio equipment with them. The Hunter Radio Group would love to have you attend this meeting and hear Jonathan's lecture. Our meeting starts at 6:30 p.m. and you will be made welcome at our friendly club. There will be a live stream of the lecture via Zoom, supplied by Amateur Radio New South Wales. Further details will be given in future broadcasts. I'm Graham, VK2FA, on behalf of the Hunter Radio Group for National WIA News.
For further information, please contact Graham, VK2FA. Worldwide Special Interest Groups, Faith, remembering the patron saint of amateur radio. History will not let anyone forget the horrors of the concentration camps of World War II. Hams in Mexico have devoted this month, August, to remembering a Polish priest considered the patron saint of amateur radio. The Franciscan friar, Maximilian Kolbe, was killed at Auschwitz in 1941, giving his life in exchange for saving a Polish army sergeant condemned by the Nazis to die. In remembrance of the priest, who was declared a saint in the Roman Catholic Church in 1982, the call sign 4A2MAX has been on air all month. Worldwide Special Interest Groups, Final Frontier. Slovakia and Romania are preparing to launch digipetting satellites following coordination of their frequencies by the International Amateur Radio Union. The Slovakian satellite, a 1U CubeSat, will have experimental slow-scan digital video as well as a digipeter operating around the clock on two different bands. Because the satellite has an educational role to fulfill, there will be messages transmitted in both CW and using AX25 occasionally. The IARU has coordinated a downlink on 436.680 MHz. The Romanian satellite is a PicoSat with the primary role of serving as a digital amateur radio repeater. A CW beacon will also be transmitted so hams can measure various properties of the signal and detect its speed by using Doppler. The satellite will also transmit low-resolution SSDV images in GFSK mode. The satellite will be using a downlink on 436.235 MHz. CW will be sent at 20 words per minute. GFSK telemetry will be sent at 500 bits per second, and GFSK SSDV will be sent at 5 kilobytes per second. Amateur radio operator hacks NASA satellite. While the phrase is eye-catching for social media, the truth is just as exciting. Amateur radio astronomer Scott Tilley, VE7TIL, has made contact with NASA's Stereo A spacecraft, which passed Earth for the first time in 17 years. The Stereo A Solar Terrestrial Relations Observatory spacecraft, we told you of again recently here on WIA National News, was launched in 2006. "I'm having fun with Stereo A," Tilley reported to spaceweather.com. He said, "The spacecraft is close to Earth, and I can now receive its signal using a small 26-inch dish in my backyard. Its channel is on 8443.58 megahertz. Worldwide special interest groups, Radio Amateur Young Timers, YOTA, Youngsters on the Air. It's Tualek, VK2 APC.
Thank you, Bruce. In Huntsville, Alabama, thousands of amateur radio enthusiasts visited Rocket City for the annual Huntsville Hamfest. And this year, something a little different which I'm sure many an Aussie Hamfest could pick up. Jessica Mollo of the Huntsville Amateur Radio Club told how, in order to try and get some more youth into the hobby and just display what it is, what we do, we actually had a youth lounge. This is where the kids could come together and actually get on the radio with us kind of coaching them, Jessica said. This annual conference had been bringing enthusiasts together since 1954 and is known as the world's friendliest hamfest. At this year's Hamfest, people were able to take part in exam sessions, sit in on one of the many forums, visit one of the many vendors, and of course take part in one of the activities in the youth lounge. For VK1 WIA National News, I'm Alec, VK2 APC in Sydney. Now back to you, Bruce.
And thanks, Alec. Worldwide special interest groups, Rescue Radio. When all else fails, after 18 months of preparation, the Bendigo Amateur Radio and Electronics Club, BARIC, will conduct the first community-focused emergency communications exercise ever held in Australia. With more, Cole, VK3 GTV.
Thanks, Bruce. Operation Radar, the rapid deployment of amateur radio, will fill a critical gap in emergency planning by providing communications resources to bushfire evacuees and regional administrators when electricity, mobile phone networks and internet have failed. On the morning of Sunday the 3rd of September, that's next Sunday, 8 bushfire places of last resort around the city of Bendigo will be activated with standalone field radio stations linked to the BARIC headquarters at Bendigo East Hall, and to outlying stations up to 300 kilometres away. The radar model was formulated in response to warnings about climate change and answers the call from all levels of government for communities to become more self-reliant in the face of regional emergencies. The City of Greater Bendigo and Mount Alexander Shire are providing observers from their emergency management teams to help evaluate the new model. Amateur operators in central Victoria are advised that the VK3RCV repeater will be used during the exercise and that stations not involved are respectfully requested not to use the repeater during the exercise, however, are welcome to monitor. HF outlier stations will be operating on 40 metres, 7.115 MHz lower sideband, and regular public announcements will be made requesting that this frequency be kept clear for exercise traffic. BARIC President Neil VK3ZVX notes that the principal points of difference between Operation Radar and previous emergency exercises are its focus on radio amateurs providing communication services to their local community, rather than acting as an adjunct to state agencies, and the fact that local knowledge plays a pivotal role in the rapid deployment of resources. This approach, he says, allows amateur radio groups greater autonomy, significantly reduces barriers to participation, ensures that communications resources are deployed to the locations most needed, and that planning is carried out with the greatest possible awareness of local conditions. Operation Radar will commence Sunday, September the 3rd at 0700 Eastern Time and will conclude shortly before 1300. A video of the exercise will be made available on the BARIC YouTube channel at a later date. For VK1 WIA National News, I'm Cole, VK3 GTV in Bendigo. And from one BARIC member to another, it's back to you, Bruce.
Thanks, Cole, VK3 GTV. Also to GK2 APC and Graham, VK2 FA for their contributions. I'm Bruce, VK3FFF from sunny Bendigo.
This is VK1WIA. All points of contacts from today's news stories are to be found in print when you read the web editions. www.wia.org.au.
2023 social scene. VK4 Sunfest happens September 9. In VK2, it's that Hunter Radio Group's meeting September 14, an online lecture by Jonathan Taylor, K1RFD, who wrote Echolink. And in VK2, Sarkfest, 8 a.m. Saturday, September 23. Now, submitting news items, if you'd like to submit news for possible inclusion in this WIA broadcast, email your item in text to nationalnews@wia.org.au and don't just send URLs or pointers. Take the time to pen your contribution the way you'd expect to hear it being read. Now, to submit audio, and we'd much sooner you did your own audio, again, email nationalnews@wia.org.au and send both the audio and the text. But we'd certainly appreciate items certainly no longer than 90 seconds in length, as we only have half an hour. Now, till we meet further down the log, I'm Graham, VK4BB. Walk softly. Oh, and remember, the sooner you submit material, the more the likelihood of it being broadcast in the very next edition of WIA National News.
From Australia, this has been the Wireless Institute of Australia with the weekly news service. This broadcast is in text, audio and video and is accessed on wia.org.au.
Courtesy of Bevan, VK5BD's ATV and YouTube channel, this has been WIA National News. We're back now, live and local, and your voice, your callbacks. And don't forget, tick like.